Ahoy. Thanks, Adam. And like all the other speakers, I should say how grateful I am to be here, to have the opportunity to be a part of this amazing event. It really is an astonishing thing and a great privilege to be sharing this stage with so many other amazing designers from all over the world. So can we have the lights down? Lights? Yeah. So I've been in the design business for quite a long time, and I came across a passport the other day from when I was just starting out on my very first job. You can probably guess from the haircut that this was the 1980s. So when Alice Nybert was doing experimental theatre in Prague, I was art editor, actually, of this magazine, which was a customer magazine for people who had American Express cards. It was one of the first customer magazines in the UK. And my job was just to do layouts and commission a little bit of illustration and photography. So it was a very simple thing to do. Life was very straightforward in those days. So 10 years later, I got a new passport. And I was living in Rome, Italy, doing this magazine, Colors for Benetton, which came out 4 times a year. It was a quarterly magazine. And after every issue, I would take a vacation and rush back to London to be the art director of the first edition, British edition of Wired magazine. So fast forward another 10 years, and I was at The Guardian redesigning the newspaper and starting to get to grips with digital, and the iPhone had just come out, so starting to get to grips with mobile. And then I just had to renew my passport a couple of weeks ago. And now I've got my own studio, and we're doing all sorts of stuff, really. So as you can see, over the course of my career, life has got a bit more complex and difficult. And when people ask me what I do, you know, I meet someone at a party and they say, what's your job? I kind of don't really know what to say. And I usually say, I'm an editorial designer. And that kind of covers it, but over the course of my career, it's become a less and less adequate description. So when I was starting out, if you were an editorial designer, you probably designed magazines, maybe newspapers, maybe books, and that was what I was doing in those days. 30 years later, I'm still designing magazines and newspapers and books, but I'm also doing a whole bunch of other stuff as well. And it makes me sometimes ask the question, what is editorial design? So today I'm going to show you some projects over the course of my whole career, but I'm also going to ask this question, what is editorial design? And I'm going to try and answer it in a few different ways. So to start with, editorial design is storytelling, and Catalane explained this very well earlier. If editorial design is about anything, it's about content. The world is full of amazing stories, and really the essence of editorial design is to find a visual form for stories. So back in the 90s, I was doing this magazine, Colors, which was published by Benetton 4 times a year. If you can read that catch line, it was called a magazine about the rest of the world. And it was a remarkable magazine in lots of different ways. One of them was the editor, this guy, Tibor Kalman, who sadly died at the age of 50, much too young. You may have heard of him. He was a great sort of luminary in the design world in the 1980s, 1990s from New York. A mad, inspiring, genius, infuriating kind of guy. But he was very inspiring to work with, and he had a great commitment to using design as a kind of content medium to tell stories. So Colors was published all over the world. It was published in 4 separate editions in different languages, but it also went to a lot of countries where it wasn't printed in that language. So the first principle of Colors when we were doing it was that every story had to be told visually. And that mainly came down to photography. So it's probably quite hard for a lot of you to imagine that there was life before the internet, but we were actually doing this magazine before the internet. There was a couple of kind of dial-up services in those days, but most of us didn't even have email. So it was before YouTube, before Flickr, way before social media. So really, if you wanted to see images from all over the world, the only place you could see them was on television and in magazines. So every issue of Colors would start with a photo essay just a series of documentary images on a particular theme. This was the shopping issue, so it's just images related to shopping from all over the world. And in those days, it was pre-digital images too, so all of these pictures were physical slides, most of them shot on 35mm film. We had photo editors in Rome, Paris, and New York sending us pictures. We would, for every issue, we'd go through about 10,000 images to edit them down to make the magazine. And one pillar of colors was this documentary photography, never processed, almost always shot on 35mm film, just capturing images, real life images from around the world. But the other pillar of it was a different kind of research, object research. So we also had correspondents all over the world who would find interesting objects for us and send them in to the office in Rome. So this is from an issue about sport where we decided to do a story about balls, different kind of balls used in different sports. So we got hockey balls, baseballs, softballs, cricket balls, but also things like this football on the left, which was handmade by a child in Senegal, because obviously he could never afford to buy a real football. So he made himself this football, and our correspondent in Senegal bought the football from him, sent it to the office, and then we would gather all these things together, get them photographed, always in the same way, always on a white background, always with very hard lighting, just to try and make them as much like objects as possible. The next best thing to being able to actually reach out and pick these things off the page. But the thing that really made Colors unique and different to almost every other magazine I've ever been involved with is that all the editing was done visually. So in most magazines, except maybe fashion magazines, but even there, there's a lot of things that happen like this. Editors commission a story, and usually that story is a piece of text, and then the art department reads the text and decides how to visualize the story. But in Colors, we did it completely the other way around. So apart from my old friends from Colors, if you look behind them on the wall, you'll see that every issue used to start as a series of very rough sketches, which Tibor would usually do himself. And if you look up in that top left-hand corner, you can see the initial sketch for that ball story, where he just kind of had the idea, what if we throw a whole bunch of balls down on this page? And then once the objects had arrived and we had had a chance to photograph them, I would do a much more detailed sketch so that we would know exactly how to configure the elements on the page. And then that would end up as a magazine layout. And only at this stage, there were a couple of writers on Colors, and only when the layout was finished did the writers get a chance to get involved, and they would come in and fill in the captions. So it was done completely the opposite way around to almost every other magazine, that it was visual editing first and words as the very last thought. So in a sense, Colors is about as pure as art direction on a magazine ever gets. It was purely about imagining visual stories and telling them in a visual way. So I only stayed there for a year. I did issues about shopping, about sport, and about travel, and always with this mix of objects, you know, an amazing $100,000 diamond-encrusted gun, or documentary images like these train surfers from Brazil. But there's another aspect to editorial design which is very, very different, and it's kind of what we do most of now, and that is design systems. So just a little bit over 10 years ago now, I did this redesign of the Guardian newspaper in England.
The Guardian has changed.
So my design for The Guardian replaced an iconic design from the 1980s by David Hillman of Pentagram. But if you've been to England recently, or if you're a user of The Guardian website or apps, you'll know that it's also just been redesigned again, and my design's been replaced, although it's not anything like as radical as what we did. But this is often what happens in the world of media, and you just have to get used to it. You do a project, it rarely lasts more than 10 or 15 years, and then somebody else gets a chance to have a go. But our project was celebrated all over the world, including in Israel, where they particularly liked it. But designing a newspaper is kind of the opposite of colors, because it has to be about delivering a design system. Something like The Guardian comes out every day. There are hundreds of pages. There's probably 30 or 40 different people involved in designing it every day. So you have to deliver something that's kind of bulletproof, really. And everything starts with a grid. So in magazines and newspapers, we tend to start with a baseline grid. We'll work out what we think is a good text typesetting style. But in editorial, we tend also to use an Ascendo grid. We have a different grid that hits the top of the characters, depending what the typeface is. And the reason for this is so we can place things like images and other design elements in a way that always aligns with the text. So the top of the images are on the Ascendo grid, and the bottom of the images are on the baseline grid. And this applies to headlines too. So you'll see these headlines are all hanging off the Ascendo grid. And also, everything has to kind of interact with the grid in a really systematic way. So you'll see each of these headlines, each line of this headline, is occupying four lines of the baseline grid. And then the next headline size down, for a slightly less important story, is occupying three lines of the baseline grid, and so on. Two lines of space underneath every headline. So you introduce systems like this to try and get consistency across every page. We also tend to build a modular grid based on that baseline grid. So in the case of The Guardian, I think there was 10 lines per module. And we also use these to determine the size of all the design elements. So things like this little gizmo here, or the headline, they're all occupying one cell of that modular grid. It's also about developing a typographic system. For The Guardian, we were lucky enough to be able to commission a bespoke typeface from the brilliant designers at Commercial Type, Paul Barnes in London, and Christian Schwartz in New York, who's already been mentioned today. And in fact, we were lucky enough to commission a whole system of fonts. We ended up with over 200 fonts in the end, by the time you'd done the text styles, the headline styles, the different weights, the italics, the sans serif, special agate for very small sizes, and so on. So a typographic system has to be developed too, and a color system. We didn't actually use all these grays, but we just became a little bit fascinated by gray as part of the process. And of course, a newspaper has a lot of different types of material in it, and some of those are very complex and can't be designed every day. So for example, the sports section is full of formats like this, how to preview or report on a football match, and all these things have to be designed in advance and delivered, down to things like the crossword. Every single part of a newspaper has to be pre-designed and delivered as a template. But the most important part of doing a newspaper design is to create an environment in which people can do storytelling. It's just not you that's doing it, it's the staff of the newspaper. So you have to be able to give them things that they can use on a very boring, rainy Wednesday in London when there isn't much news, but they can also use when something really kind of dramatic and earth-shattering happens, and it has to be able to deal with that range of events and possibilities. And you also try and create spaces for visual journalism. So in this design, the center pages of The Guardian were always one amazing, large news image, just big enough to fill your field of vision, or a giant infographic. And you deliver these tools, and then it's really up to the staff of the newspaper to combine them, to use the grids, the typefaces, the colors, the infographic styles, the photography, the layout principles, in order to develop a way of telling their own stories. And on a big newspaper, you're often looking at something that's got 10 to 15 different sections. So you're delivering literally hundreds of templates and sometimes thousands of style sheets, just to give the team there an opportunity to do their own visual storytelling. So there is another aspect to editorial design that hit me about halfway through my career, having worked in print on magazines and newspapers. And of course, that is digital. And digital kind of rocked everybody's world who was used to working in print in those times, particularly in the media. And in digital, it is a kind of systems design again, generally, but it's a different approach to systems design. So this is the first digital project, pretty much, that I ever did, the Guardian website, which followed on from the newspaper redesign. And it looks pretty dated now, but they liked it at the time, particularly in China. And it was launched at a happier time 10 years ago when we can remember an election in America which had a slightly more pleasing result than the last one. So, you know, this looks pretty dated now, but it was kind of state of the art at the time. But coming from a print background and immersing myself in digital was a real shock to me because you do have to learn a completely different way of thinking. And I guess, you know, probably a lot of you are digital natives and have an instinctive understanding of what digital is. But having spent 15 years in print, it was a real shock to me to find out just how different digital is. So when we do a digital project, like this is a news website in Barcelona that we did a couple of years ago, the basic design elements in terms of space and typography and color and so on are a bit like what we do in print. And it's very tempting to fall into the trap of thinking of it as kind of like a print design. We even call it a page. We call it a web page. But of course, it's not a page. It's a computer program. And what this page really is just a whole stack of code that lives on a web server somewhere. And you know, you decide you want to load this page. That program is sent over a wire to you. And it's only when it lands on your computer in your browser that it gets rendered into an intelligible visual form. And that's pretty mind-blowing anyway. But of course, the problem is we don't know what device you're looking at it on. You might be looking on a big screen, a small screen, a phone, a tablet. So we now have to do digital design without actually knowing what the end result is going to be, which is even more mind-blowing. So 5 or 6 years ago, this principle came in called responsive design, which is very familiar to us now. But at the time, it was a really shocking and sort of difficult thing to cope with. It's now very natural to us to understand that websites have to mutate and change depending on the size of the viewport so that we design something that can work on a big screen and a small screen. But it's, from a designer's point of view, it's really, really hard. And, you know, working from laptops to phones is hard enough. We're also coming into a world where we're having to design for bigger screens, like TVs, wearables, cars. And I can't think of any other kind of design that's like this, because if you're designing a magazine or a book or a poster or a chair or a building, you know what size the end result is going to be. You know the physical format that it's going to exist in. But when you're designing for digital, you really don't know what the end user is going to see. And you kind of have to design it not quite 100 times, but you have to have an awareness of the possibilities. Somebody might be looking at it on a browser that's 10 years old. So it's really challenging from the design point of view to define this kind of design. We also have to be aware that the people we work with are also publishing outside their own domains. So you may not even see our clients on their website. You know, if you see the New York Times or National Geographic, you might come across them on Snapchat or Facebook, not on the pages that we design. And the other thing that's really different and really challenging to a designer about digital is that we now have completely accurate real-time metrics about how the things we design are being used. So when we used to design a magazine or a newspaper, we had no idea really who was reading it and how they were reading it. We knew who was buying it, but we didn't know if they were buying it and throwing it straight in the bin. But now we know exactly how many people are on a website at any moment. We know exactly which pages they're on. We know exactly how long they've spent there. And that's really demanding because you follow your design instincts as you always have, and it may turn out that you got it completely wrong and that people don't like using what you made. So you have to be able to react to that and change. And that, again, is a real challenge to the way of thinking that you build up in print. And probably the last thing from a professional point of view that makes digital really different is that the medium changes every day. So, you know, I learned pretty much how magazines and newspapers work 25 years ago. But every week there's some new development in digital technology that affects designers, and particularly actually at the moment, there are two really important things happening. New ways of putting pages together like CSS grid and variable fonts. So working in the digital space now is a bit like being in full-time education. Every day you have to keep relearning your craft. And then the other really important aspect of editorial design, which only became clear to me quite recently, really, is that editorial design has a lot in common with brand identity. So this is a project we did a few years ago for a TV network in the Netherlands, the biggest commercial TV network in the Netherlands, RTL, which has several million viewers, so it's a big mainstream audience. And I'm delighted to see that this project is in the Biennale exhibition at the Moravian Gallery in the motion graphics section, curated by Movo. So if you go there, you can see a little bit of this on the big screen in the dark room, and you can see a case study movie about it on the tablets that they have there. But RTL initially came to me because they wanted a new website. And we actually worked on the website project, and we delivered it as they wanted us to. But it became clear during the meetings for the website project that they were also going to be doing a rebrand of the TV network. And I liked the idea of doing the website, but I didn't like the idea of somebody else doing the rebrand. So even though I'd never done any television work in my life and I'd never really done what I thought of as a rebrand in my life, I said in the meeting, oh, you should get us to do this. And of course they called us out on it and asked us to show them some ideas, and eventually we won the project, which was fantastic, but quite scary, because I thought, brand identity design, I've never done this. But actually, when I thought about it and looked back over my work, I began to realize that it wasn't just something that Pentagram do and Wolf Olins do, which is what I'd imagined. I thought it was a completely different kind of discipline to what I was used to doing. But I remembered that we'd done this newspaper in Portugal called Publico, which is based in Lisbon, but actually has an office in Porto as well and does some great stuff there. And, you know, we delivered this kind of like the Guardian redesign, a series of templates, a series of style sheets, a style guide. But along with that, we gave them a bunch of assets and a color system, including this logo. And it turned out that actually, this was a pretty good logo, which they were able to use in lots of other contexts too. And almost without realizing it, by designing a newspaper and delivering a color system and a logo, we'd given them the basics of a brand identity program anyway. And then The Guardian was a very similar kind of thing, really. The original project was a newspaper redesign, and then we had to roll that visual language out across all the digital projects. And it became an advertising campaign, which Wieden & Kennedy did, based on the color system and the design principles that we'd introduced. And it also became the basis of an environmental project when The Guardian moved into new offices. And we worked with an agency called Cartledge Levine on all this signage and so on. So again, I began to think that actually, maybe brand identity design is not something completely different from what I've done before. And in fact, every editorial project is an identity project. But there was another aspect of RTL which was equally intimidating, and that was motion, because I really hadn't done much motion design before. And in that case, I wasn't able to just call on my own resources or studio resources. So I thought, how am I gonna do this? And I ended up, as you do when you get into a field that you don't have much experience in, you collaborate with the experts. So I did this project with my great friend Dylan Griffith, who's a Welsh art director who lives in Amsterdam, and he had worked at MTV as a creative director there. He'd worked with the BBC before, so he brought the television experience. But Dylan is Welsh and I'm Scottish, so it seemed a bit weird to be designing a TV station in the Netherlands, so we thought we'd better have somebody Dutch on the team. So we teamed up with a brilliant motion designer and animator in Amsterdam called John Beckers. But we began, even though it's a different medium, we approached the project in the same way that we would approach a magazine redesign, by starting off with the design history of the client, which in this case was not particularly distinguished. So that was the identity that they had at the time that they commissioned us. And then we look at that in the context of the competition. So that was the RTL identity. Their main competitor was NOS, the Dutch state broadcaster. But you can also get BBC in the Netherlands, and you can also get Al Jazeera. So if you look at these, you may start to see a certain theme emerging in television design. And the more I dug into it, the less I could believe how basically everybody was doing exactly the same stuff. And I couldn't help being reminded of a great TV show that used to be on British television, which was a comedy about a kind of fake TV news channel called The Day Today. So this is comedy, but it's actually not very different from what most television design looks like these days. And we went on a really interesting little journey trying to work out where that iconography came from. And it starts in the 1930s with Pathé newsreels in cinemas.
Here is an illustrated summary of the news. It will be followed by the latest film of events and happenings at home and abroad.
And in those days, I think the globe represented the fact that these guys had access. You know, you couldn't go to the other side of the world to see an event, but these guys could take a film of it and bring it back to you and show you in the cinema. And then this was followed up in the 50s by television news. So these kind of pulsating radio waves, I think, represent the kind of incredible technology of television and radio. And when you put these things together, the world globe, the pulsating radio waves, you get what most television design looks like these days. But it was clear to us that this kind of idea of the all-powerful broadcaster who has unique access to what's going on in the world is crazy in an age when you can get on Instagram and find out more about what's happening in Syria than you can from television news. So we set ourselves a rule, no shiny, pulsating, spinning globes. So we needed some other kind of iconography to represent the concept of TV news. And we started looking at the different places you could watch RTL, obviously on linear TV, but also on your tablet, on your phone. And the one thing they all had in common was this rectangular flame, usually black. Every image was mediated by this frame. And it became a really nice metaphor for TV news because the information's all out there on the internet. All television can do is edit and select. So this idea that you frame part of the world because you think it's important and you deliver that to your audience became a really nice metaphor for what we were doing. And then I had a momentary revelation one day when I was looking at my iPad and I realized that the top left-hand corner kind of looked like an R. And then the rest was very simple, really. We had this frame which we split into quadrants and that became the basis of the RTL wordmark, which we used first of all in the news channel, but actually it much more recently with a different color system became the identity for the whole RTL Nederland network. But to start doing the technical work on this project, again, it's not so different from designing a magazine because you start with a grid. So we have our kind of 16:9 format, we have a baseline grid, and we introduce typographic elements onto that in a way that's not dissimilar to what we do in a newspaper, it's just that everything moves. And when you put all these things together with the live action feed, you get this. And information graphics are a really important part of a lot of the work that we do, working with print publishers, but particularly in television. A lot of television graphics are really, really bad. You know, they don't explain the story in a particularly good way, and they tend to use a lot of gradients and useless images grayed out in the background and really get in the way of the information design. And we wanted to ensure that the graphic system that we delivered to RTL was a proper piece of information design where there's no extraneous decoration to get in the way, but just a clean, modern approach to telling stories through information graphics. So you can see some of these graphics are what we call full program. They're taking over the whole of the television screen, but also a lot of the graphics were appearing on these massive wide format TV screens in the studio. And that was a whole other aspect of the project, which we hadn't anticipated. They had to have a new set as well. Of course, again, we didn't have the expertise to do that, so we collaborated with a Belgian studio, had a lot of experience in TV set design, and they took our idea of the frame and developed this system with these four massive screens. And a lot of TV stations nowadays have what's called a virtual set. It only exists inside a computer. But this was actually a physical set that got built out of real materials. So watching this thing go up was an incredible experience for someone who mainly does magazines and websites, seeing these enormous physical objects taking shape and ending up with a really dramatic environment in which we could display information graphics, photography, and ambient footage. And then, of course, the most controversial part of the bit that everybody focuses on with any kind of TV news rebrand is the title sequence of the news. This is where the news announcers now come in and tell you what's going on. So we developed this animation with Universal Everything, or an amazing studio in Britain, again, represented in the Biennale exhibition in the motion graphics section. And there is a kind of narrative here of packets of information arriving and getting down lower and lower into city level, block level, and then street level. And in order to generate this, first of all, we had to build a city in 3D. And they did this in a really interesting way of taking maps of various Dutch cities like Amsterdam and Utrecht and The Hague, and then combining them together. So it's a kind of theoretical, hypothetical Dutch city. It's not recognizable, but it has the same proportion of land to water and buildings of the same height and so on as most Dutch cities do. And that's the raw form. And then the extra elements that were added in, these particular elements were all done using generative design. So they don't decide where to place these things. The particles representing the users, the viewers interacting with the station, all these particles are behaving according to a program. And of course, TV news happens throughout the course of the day. So that was the morning bulletin when you see the sun rise. In the evening, the sun sets. And then my personal favorite is the late night news, where you get a moon instead of the sun. And continuing that theme of homages and imitations, a bit like Julian's t-shirt, a TV station in Malaysia came out with this. I think that is a virtual set. They didn't build the set. So I'm just going to talk about a couple of projects which kind of bring all these themes together. And the first one is Internazionale, who are one of our best clients. We've been working with them for 10 years now. And Internazionale is a weekly magazine out of Rome in Italy with an incredibly passionate audience. In fact, I was speaking to Enrica from Zaven, who's on stage tomorrow, and she told me it was her favorite magazine, which is a lovely thing to hear. you would guess by the name, it's a magazine that's interested in what's going on all over the world. And it really sets itself in contrast to most Italian news magazines, which are very obsessed with Italian politics. They're full of gossip, whereas Internazionale has a very liberal outlook on the world. It translates and republishes a lot of amazing journalism from places like the New York Times, the New Yorker, the Guardian, and Le Monde. So they really wanted something that was different from the normal Italian news magazine. And most Italian news magazines are very bold, very colorful, lots of decoration, lots of pictures. But we decided to take our lead more from their heroes, which are The New Yorker and The Economist. So we delivered them a design that's very formatted, again, a kind of systematic design, very detailed typography, lots of different elements, quite templated. We decided to do it all in one typeface, so absolutely everything from the smallest type to the biggest type in Internazionale is in Leon, some slightly different cuts and weights, but there's only one typeface. But we also asked the designers of Leon, Carvalho Bonao, to do a special stencil version which we used for the logo type and also for labeling and branding elements. So you can see a lot of it is a kind of systems design, very similar to what I was talking about with newspapers, very intense pages, lots of elements, quite text-heavy features, complex reviews pages with lots of different things happening on them, but also some spaces for bigger headlines, bigger typography, and some spaces for photography. Not that many, but dramatic double-page images. We deliver things like this usually. We deliver a whole bunch of assets, but the key ones are a series of InDesign templates. So in this case, there were probably 40 or 50 InDesign templates. Each has its own set of style sheets. So on a job like this, you're probably up to 100 or 200 style sheets. Everything has its relationship to the grid. So you can see like that headline for the sidebar occupies two lines of the grid. And we deliver what we call a mother, which is just a series of layouts that represent every part of the magazine, a few design possibilities for the more flexible ones, and just something that gives them, you know, everything they need in order to build the magazine every week, because it's got a pretty small team. So in some ways, Internazionale with two or three designers is a bit like The Guardian with 30 designers. They do it every week. The Guardian does it every day. So most of what we've done for them was this kind of systems design, but we do continue to work with them. We do covers for them. My slide is not changing. There we go. Oh, back. Okay, sorry, you're gonna have to watch this GIF again. Something about this makes the next slide appear very slowly. So we're on a retainer with them. We talk to them about the cover every week. They do most of the covers, but every now and then we get involved in the covers too. So we have a bit of fun with those. The stories are very varied. They do very different kinds of things. So on the left is a story about the Greek crisis, where we got Kai Bonao, who designed the typeface, to redraw the logo in Greek, or a story about water. And Internazionale also has its fans and imitators. I don't know what this magazine is, but it looks pretty good. So after we delivered the print magazine, they came to us about the website, and they had great ambitions at this time to be a serious news source on the web in Italy, because the websites of the big Italian newspapers and magazines are actually, the journalistic standards are very low. But they wanted to do something a bit different from most people. So we came up with this idea of a chronological feed, bit more like a kind of Instagram feed or a Facebook timeline, where stories keep coming in and every story pushes away the story before it. But they found that actually the most popular thing that everybody seemed to be reading was this thing, which was a summary they published once a day, just rounding up the most important stories in the world that day. And that was the main focus. So they asked us to go back and do it again, but with that at the top, and that's in a fixed position. So that got longer and a bit more in depth. And then the chronological feed began below that, so that element wouldn't be pushed away. But then, after they'd been working on this for a bit over a year, I think, they had a change of heart and they asked themselves some serious questions about what digital was really doing for them. It was costing them a lot of money to maintain a big digital news team, and they weren't really getting anything back from that in terms of revenue. And the audience seemed to be more interested in the magazine than they were in the website. So they actually made a really radical decision, which was to no longer have a free website, to do something much more like a conventional magazine website, but for subscribers only. The paywall, I don't think, is quite in yet, but it'll be there soon. So this was a much more normal approach to doing a magazine website. But of course, most people actually see it on mobile because it's quite a young audience. And video became a very important part of what they were doing too. In the same way that they would take articles from around the world and translate them into Italian, they also found that they could, without spending too much money, syndicate some of the great video that people like the New Yorker and the New York Times were doing. So video became a very prominent feature of the site. So they asked us to do a bit of motion branding and sound branding that they could run at the beginning of all their videos. And as I explained, Internazionale's audience is very committed. They're really proud of their relationship with the magazine. And they also want to buy stuff from the magazine. So we found ourselves starting to design a little bit of merch for them. You're probably getting tote bag fatigue by now. I think this is probably the 20th tote bag you've seen in the last 2 days. You know, nothing amazing, bags, t-shirts, mugs, the usual kind of stuff. But interesting for us, because it's not the kind of thing that we would normally do. And also, once a year, they have a conference in Ferrara, a beautiful university city in the north of Italy. And we got involved in doing the branding for that as well, just as a kind of offshoot of the main Internazionale branding. So some of the environmental stuff and the banners and the signs and the programs and so on. And then the last thing we've been doing for them is, as part of this drive away from digital and back towards print, they've started publishing a special magazine 4 times a year on an individual theme. So the first one we did for them was last October for the anniversary of the Russian Revolution. And then we did one at Christmas about the best sort of books and movies and music of the year. And then the most recent one we've done, I was particularly excited about, because they wanted to do something to celebrate the anniversary of 1968, particularly the student riots in Paris and the Prague Spring, of course, the death of Martin Luther King. But they wanted to do it in a different format that was less like the magazine, so we decided to make a newspaper. And I'm a really big fan of the underground newspapers of the 60s and 70s, like the very early newsprint editions of Rolling Stone, or things like International Times and Friends. So we were able to make this magazine and kind of pretend that we were stoned hippie art directors in 1968. So we made something that's a basic kind of news structure, but using these psychedelic colors and printing images in only one or two colors. Janis Joplin, Robert Crumb, just great stuff, really. That was about the most fun I've had in the last year. So with a client like Internazionale, it's sort of weird because we started off by doing a piece of magazine design, and almost by accident, we've become a sort of multidisciplinary design studio without ever really meaning to. But when you have a relationship like that with a client, you end up getting involved in lots of different parts of their activities. And then the last project I'm going to show you is Domus, which some of you may have heard of. Domus is an amazing magazine about architecture, but also design and art. It's a big magazine, beautiful magazine. As Catalan was saying, it's got a great smell, it's heavy. It's just one of those incredible things, but it also has an amazing cultural history. So Adam told us earlier it was founded in 1928 by the Italian architect Giò Ponti. But from my point of view, what I found more interesting was its really astonishing design history. Some of the biggest names in design have been involved creatively with this magazine. So in the early 80s, the art director was Ettore Sozzas. You see this issue is about the young architects of California, and that's a very young Frank Gehry there. And then following on from Ettore Sozzas was Italo Lupi, who I think is probably the greatest Italian graphic designer of all time. And in the 90s, it was done by the amazing Alan Fletcher. So a very powerful design history and a very intimidating design history for someone who's coming in to do some design for this client. But we started with the website. And again, you know, you start with the competition and you look at what other people are doing. And it's interesting the graphic language that has evolved around architecture. You see it in books, you see it in some architecture magazines, and you also see it on the web in the big magazines, but also some of the blogs. They tend to be quite monochromatic, and I think this is to do with that thinking that A Practice for Everyday Life were talking about earlier in their response to art, that you want it to be kind of black and white so it doesn't interfere too much with the architecture that you're showing. And they also tend to be very linear and geometrical. And in the minds of graphic designers, there seems to be a connection between the sort of Swiss graphic design style or the Ulm school and architecture, because it's a kind of blocky architectonic approach. But from my point of view, you know, the glory of Domus is its crazy design history. And particularly for me, the golden age was this period in the 80s, the kind of Memphis period, when Tsatsas and Italo Luppi were doing just completely bonkers things with it. So we didn't want it to be another kind of black and white, very gritty architecture product. And it's been going so long, and it's had so many incredible people associated with it, that there's a really rich kind of design history that you can find things that you find interesting. And one of the things we spotted was that certain periods favored a vertical logo. Some of the art directors and editors thought that was a more interesting way of using the logo. So we isolated that and wondered if we could do something with that on the web, because it's not something you see very often on the web. And the other thing that we saw was color, loads and loads of color. Domus has always been a very colorful magazine, using color in a really expressive way, not afraid to compete with the photography. And we wanted that to be a part of what we did too. So we came up with this color system based on the different sections of the website, where there's a clearly defined range of colors for each part. Typographically, we started with the logo. It's one of those iconic logos that's been going since it wasn't there in the very beginning. I think it came in the 1940s, but we didn't want to mess with it. But Paul Barnes from Commercial Type developed an alphabet based on the logo. And we decided we were going to combine this with a typeface called Forma, which is a really interesting typeface. Originally, it was published in Hot Metal by the Caratteri Nebbiolo Type Foundry in Turin, in Italy. And the story goes that Nebbiolo had a lot of really eccentric, unusual typefaces, including Eurostyle, which Benjamin was talking about yesterday. But they found that all the graphic designers in Milan wanted to use Helvetica and Accidents Grotesque. So they thought, oh, we need a neutral sans serif too. But their main typographer, Aldo Novarese, didn't really know how to do that stuff. So they put together a committee of the best graphic designers in Milan. And as it happens, three of them were current or former art directors of Domus. So there was a real family connection between Forma and Domus. So they were trying to make this kind of neutral, grotesque typeface. But being Italian, they didn't really want to do that. So there's lots of alternate characters in Forma, but there are some quite Helvetica-ish ones, like the ones at the top, if you look at the R and the A and the G. But there's also a lot of alternates, and things like the single story A really give the typeface an individual character. I'm going for the biggest type in the whole conference here. I hope no one's got a slide with a bigger type on it. And you can see it's got rounded corners on the terminals, and the verticals are not vertical. There's a kind of flair to them. So that even though they were setting out to make a neutral grotesque, they ended up with something that's really got a lot of spirit and kind of, it seems to me, Italian character to it. So that was the main typeface. But there's lots of different types of content on the site. We needed something a bit more straightforward and a serif to mix it with. So we went with Tiempos, which is Chris Sowersby's retake on Times Roman. And it seemed like in the same way that Forma was the kind of cool, quirky Helvetica, Tiempos is the cool, quirky Times Roman. So this is what we ended up with. So you can see the vertical logo. And as you scroll the logo, is this going to work? My last animation didn't work. Dang, yeah, okay. So as the different parts of the page come in, the color fields, which represent the different parts of the magazine, wipe across the logo. So there's just a little bit of kind of fun behavior around the logo that got away from the sort of po-faced seriousness of a lot of architecture products. We also wanted to make sure that we didn't have everything too square and aligning. So you can see we made these modular elements which are positioned with the padding already in them, to make sure that in between these big blocks, there's a kind of slightly random feel to it. But again, of course, a lot of people aren't seeing it like that. They're seeing it like this. But we still tried to keep that sort of, not have it too aligned, and there's padding built into a lot of these elements to make sure that it still dances around a little bit as you scroll up and down. And then following on from the website project, they asked us to think about the magazine. Now, Domus is an unusual magazine in that the editor changes always every few years, and the editor tends to not be a magazine person. It's usually a famous designer or architect. And it was founded in 1928, so the 100th anniversary is in 10 years' time. And in order to prepare for that, they came up with this idea that for the next 10 years, there will be 10 different editors who will each do 10 issues of the magazine. So they wanted to introduce a new design for the year of the new editor from this year until next year. So we looked for our inspiration in lots of different places. Of course, the archive is an incredible resource. So we spent days in the Domus archive just going through its amazing history, particularly looking at these kind of 1980s, 1990s period magazines. We also had the inspiration from the digital project that we'd already done, which will last longer than the print design probably, because that won't change at the end of this year. So we wanted to have some connection with that, but not too much connection with it. And then the rest of the inspiration came from the new editor, who is this guy, Michele Di Lucchi, who's actually one of the original members of the Memphis group with Sotsas back in the 80s. You probably know him best as the designer of the Tolomeo lamp, which is the lamp that half of us have in our studio at least. But Michele also runs an international design architecture practice working all over the world from China to Argentina. And he's also an artist. He does drawings and paintings, but he particularly is interested in making sculptures out of timber, which are kind of like architectural forms, but they're often very different. And sometimes his art kind of finds its way into his architecture, but sometimes he just makes these kind of architectural sculptures and they have nothing to do with his design practice. But he's a really interesting guy. He, as you can imagine, from someone who's running a world-class architecture practice. He has very strong ideas about what he wants, but he was really interesting to work with. And we got some strange inspirations from him like this. This is Michele's diary, which he draws by hand. He has a blank diary, and he draws it by hand every week in pencil. He draws in the different days. And then he always writes across the gutter, which is, you know, as print designers, we're always told not to do. We keep the gutter clear. But Michele loves working across the gutter. And he said that he wanted to do that in the magazine too, in some places. Typographically, we already had the former, but we didn't want to just follow exactly the typefaces we were using on the website. So we spoke to a great type designer called David Jonathan Ross, who actually is the person who digitized former from the original Nebbiolo lead type. And he was working on a slab serif version, which is another old Nebbiolo typeface called Datilo. So we brought that along as well. But we thought maybe everything was getting a little bit too architectural here. So the serif that we chose is this slightly crazy thing, also from David, called Gimlet, which has these really big slabby serifs, and just really added a bit of that kind of Italo-loopy 1980s postmodern sort of flavor. So as usual, delivering a magazine project is about developing a whole bunch of style sheets and different type styles. Although in this case, we didn't do what we normally do. Normally, we have a set of headline styles, a set of text styles, a set of picture caption styles, and so on. But here we just said, we're just going to have a bunch of sizes. So we defined the basic text typesetting, which had a 12.3-point line feed. And then we just said, okay, you can have plus 25% that, plus 50%, plus 50%. 7,500, blah, blah, blah. So every piece of type in the magazine is some multiple of this baseline, but we didn't really make a distinction between headlines, captions, or text. It's just all type styles that are available to you to do what you want with. And we delivered a color system, which, because of Domus's amazing history with color, we wanted to be as rich as possible. So we had a lot more colors here than we would normally deliver on a magazine project. And this is what we did. So this is Michele's editorial with a little drawing by Michele of himself. And you can see here that we tried to do that thing that Michele does in his diary by setting a single column of type very big across the gutter, which goes against every instinct you have as a magazine designer, but was kind of fun. And the other thing that this shows is that I felt it was very important that if Domus considered itself an international magazine, that the languages should have equal status. So Domus is published in Italian and English. And a lot of the designers in the past, kind of to make their lives easier, I think, had often had a big Italian headline and a small English headline, or a big English headline and a small Italian headline, because it's just easier to work with, because you have twice as many headlines, twice as many intros, twice as much text as you have in a normal magazine. But I felt that it was very important that the languages should have completely equal status. So the Italian is always the same size as the English. So after a text-heavy spread like that, the opposite extreme was visual storytelling, a little bit like colors. So this was a story they did about some Japanese architects who obsessively catalog all the cardboard models they make of every building they design, and their whole studio has this vast storage area made up of these models. But there were also the conventional architecture features. But Michele is very interested in objects. He even sees architecture as objects. So it connects very much to his sculpture, these small wooden things that he makes. And he says that, you know, most architects will tell you that when they design a building, it's about the context or about the human interaction with the building. But he says that that's all rubbish. A building is an object. It's just a form that has a shape. And he was very keen to represent architecture as objects. So even to the extent of taking this Frank Gehry house in Los Angeles completely out of context, cutting out the image and putting a silhouette. Michele thinks in a very artistic way as well, and he was very keen to get away from the conventional kind of architecture photography style. So he wanted to work more with art photographers like Ramak Fazel in this case. And color, as I said, was a very important part of this new design, trying to get away from that kind of monochrome approach to architecture. Although there were some stories in which a palette of grays seemed to be the best solution. So here again, you can see that the headlines, always both languages, getting exactly the same treatment. Color again being used in a very forceful way, even on the listings pages, and also just trying to make sure that the levels are not too regular and that the typography is allowed to dance on the page. And this was the cover of the first issue. The genesis of this was quite interesting. I spent a lot of time in Michele's studio looking at things with him, looking at books and magazines. And one of the things that he showed me was a wonderful book of really detailed illustrations of insects, which was, I don't know, from the 1970s or something. And we spent a lot of time with this, and I took a lot of pictures. And then back in London, we were thinking of ideas for how we could treat the covers. And we sent hundreds of ideas. But I did one of them using this ladybird illustration, which Michele really loved. So he took this idea away and worked with one of the guys he uses to render architectural images in his studios. And this became the final cover of the magazine. It has a gatefold. There's a gatefold which folds out and has Michele's kind of manifesto on there. But what you probably can't see from here is that he made a building out of this ladybird. So the legs are ramps that people can use to access the building. It's architecturally sound. You know, there's this timber frame with a cladding over the top. There's got vehicles and stuff in there. So he took the idea of the insect and made a fantastical imaginary building out of it. And that's become the theme of all the covers. So every issue has an idea, which makes sense largely to Michele and not to anybody else. But this one was about rebellion, reason and silence. But they're always these hypnotic, sort of dreamlike imaginary buildings. And what I really love about these is that they remind me of album covers from when I was growing up, the sort of progressive rock album covers from the 1970s. I don't know if you're familiar with the work that studios like Hypnosis did for Pink Floyd, or an artist called Roger Dean did for Yes. They're often these hyper-real images of sort of imaginary spaces. So I love those. And then the last thing we had to do, Michele's doing 10 issues, and then another editor's doing 10 issues. So we had to find a way of making Michele's 10 issues feel like a unit. So I asked an illustrator in London called Ian Wright to do an illustration of Michele. Ian makes portraits of people out of real physical things. So in this case, we were quite tight for time, so he just did it out of Lego pieces. And of course, Michele's got a fantastic face and an incredible beard. So he was a perfect person to do a portrait of. And then the idea is that on every issue, you'll get a slice of this portrait. So we've published 5 of Michele's issues now, and by the end of the year, you'll be able to see the whole portrait. So that was the project, and we were pretty much done with it, but then they wanted to launch the magazine. There was a big event in Milan in a big theater like this. So they asked us to just do some typographic animations around these themes of Michele's, these sort of conceptual words. So we just kept it very, very simple. Simple former typography, using the color palette that we developed for the magazine, and Michele was kind of talking to these words as they were going up on the screen. So once again, it's not quite as wide-ranging as Internazionale, but we went into an editorial project and we ended up doing a magazine and a website and some motion graphics. So this is the world that we're working in now. Life has become much richer and much more complex, and it's really hard to say whether the original definition of editorial design is still appropriate. So we've seen that editorial design is storytelling, systems design, brand identity, and motion. But it's also print, digital, broadcast, and products, and environments. But to put it another way, editorial design is content, and if anything, that's the essence of it. The content motivates everything that we do. Design, editorial design is a language, and there's no point in speaking a language unless you've got something to say. So content is at the heart of it, but personality is very important too. You know, the clients that we work with don't just want to deliver information to people, they want people to have an emotional relationship with them, and the way that you do that is by creating a design that expresses their personality. It's also about behavior, increasingly. So some of the things that we make have behavior, the websites, the motion graphics that we're doing are not static, they're doing things. But it's also about the behavior of the audience now and how the audience interacts with our products. You know, it's not just a simple reading process. The audience is actually having an interaction with a lot of the things that we make. But there's one other thing which editorial design is, which I haven't mentioned earlier, and it's not the first thing we think about. We try to get all these things right first. But if we have time before we deliver, we like to make things beautiful too. Jacqueline.
Thank you, Mark, very much. It was a great opportunity to share with us your amazing collection of works. You started in the 80s, and yep. Now you are always challenging yourself to do, new systems, new concepts. Yeah. You are using new technologies. We are all so young here, and a lot of us is doing like playing with the paper and nice emboss and so right. on, but you are always challenging the technologies. What do you think in general is important, or what is the biggest challenge in the near future for editorial design?
If I knew that, I'd probably be very rich by now. I don't know what the next challenge is going to be. I mean, clearly media is constantly changing, and with the arrival of digital media, we have to work in a very different way. The next set of interfaces, I think, might not be visual. You know, there might be sound interfaces, so we might be interacting with things more by having a conversation with them. That's pretty challenging for graphic design. But I think, in general, it's probably a good thing for us in that language is becoming more visual. So younger people, I'm sure some of the people here, and if I look at my children now, my 14-year-old son communicates with his friends mainly by sending pictures. And sometimes he's putting stickers on them or emojis or whatever, but he's expressing how he feels through images. So actually visual communication of feelings and ideas is something that there's only going to be more of in the future. So I think there'll always be a role for design to play.
And we had a lecture also of Aleš Neibert, who showed more or less his like kind of alternative underground work. Did you do something like that, like some independent magazines on your own, your self-initiated projects during your career?
I did student stuff. So I went to Oxford University and I did a magazine when I was at Oxford. The main thing I did under the radar was some friends of mine were musicians, and I used to do all their album and single covers. They're called Cold Cut. I don't know if anybody has heard of them. They're DJs, and they were in that original kind of 1980s collage movement of cutting up other people's music. And, you know, they're still DJing. I don't really have time to get involved in their stuff anymore. But I've got a whole bunch of stuff that I did in the format of sleeves for 12-inch vinyl that's in my cellar somewhere that I take out every now and then and put on the turntable.
Thank you. Some questions? Oh, lots of questions.
Hello. Okay. I hope I'll be as precise as possible in my question. Because you said it's important for the product to have its own personality, and I was thinking about the personality of the designer within that product. What does it mean to you?
Sorry, I'm not sure I understood. When I talk about personality, am I talking about the personality of the designer?
Yes. So what I understood, what you said, is that it's very important for the product to have its own personality.
That's a misunderstanding, because actually I don't want to disagree with Catalin, but in the work that I do, I don't want anyone to see my personality. Mm. I don't think it's my job to put myself in the design. I'm there to represent the client. So when I talk about personality, I mean finding a visual voice for the personality of the client. So say on a magazine like Internazionale, it's very important to them that they're perceived as having the same kind of journalistic mission as people like The New Yorker and The Economist. So that leads you in the direction of a very disciplined typographic language. Whereas something like Domus, you know, has this history of very colorful, expressive design. And unlike a lot of architecture magazines where they feel that the architecture is a star and the design should be on a lower level, Domus always seems to have felt that the opinion of the editor of Domus is just as important as the work that he's showing. So that had to be much more colorful and dynamic and have a louder typographic voice. So when I talk about editorial design being like brand identity, you know, it's not quite like designing a bank or a petrol company, but you are working with brands that people have very emotional relationships with. And, you know, people watching TV or reading newspapers and magazines can become very passionate about them. So you can condition their emotional responses. And that's what the personality element is really about.
Okay, thank you.
Do you feel like printed editorial is losing its authenticity because of the evolution of digitals? And do you think that every big magazine should be transposed to the kind of digital sphere?
I think it's really interesting, and again, Catalin's touched on this, and if Steve Watson had been able to make it yesterday, he would have spoken very eloquently about this. What's interesting now is that the digital revolution seems to have caused a whole new wave of passion for print. And there's loads of really exciting, generally pretty small independent magazines out there doing really interesting things with a lot of energy and commitment. So I don't think digital is taking the kind of initiative away from print. But you can see that a lot of the clients that we work with are quite mainstream and have a big audience, you know, TV stations with millions of viewers or newspapers with hundreds of thousands of readers. So, you know, I think in the mass media, digital has become much more important, and particularly with news. You know, we do a lot of work with news clients, and people want to get their news from digital because it's just more up to date. So with something like a newspaper, inevitably the printed version is going to be in decline and the digital version is going to increase. But there's still this wonderful opportunity to do beautiful tactile magazines, as Catalin was saying, and that's a really nice kind of thing to respond to. So, you know, in general, things are going more digital, but it doesn't mean that there isn't still an opportunity to do beautiful and exciting and really passionate things in print.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, firstly, congratulations on such a brilliant lifetime of work. I actually have the first redesigned Guardian magazine on my shelf, hoping that it will be worth a lot of money.
Yeah, I hope so too. I've got lots.
My question is, in sort of such a kind of constrained and serious body of work, and following on from the question before about personality, the question I was thinking the whole talk is, what's the thinking behind the MPA logo and the roundness? Is that yourself going wild?
That's about as crazy as I get. The hardest thing is to do your own brand, yeah. I think, and the second hardest thing is to do your own website. So for years and years, we didn't even have a website. We now have a website that's quite old, that doesn't have a CMS that we upload projects to every kind of 2 years. But everything that we do, as you can see, is in graphic from Commercial Type, because they're kind of friends of mine, and I love the typeface. So this is all graphic from Commercial Type. And we set the MPA in graphic, and we just thought it was like, it's just a bit of typesetting. So we just asked Christian Schwartz to kind of round off the corners for a bit of fun. And actually, even though, you know, I work with a lot of kind of serious information, and I guess I'm quite a serious guy. I come from Scotland, and we don't laugh much in Scotland. But I'm also really in love with the design of the 60s and 70s, and kind of the 80s as well. So that's why I had so much fun doing that 1968 thing. And these kind of rounded typefaces were quite a thing in magazines and packaging and stuff in the 70s. So it's a little kind of game for myself as well. But that wasn't what you were meant to be looking at. You were meant to be looking at all this stuff. Another question?
Hello.
Hi.
I have a question, basically, rather your view, given your long career and experiences with the editorial. How do you view the current phenomenon of fake news?
Of
fake news.
Fake news.
Yeah.
Fake news is a problem. And, you know, the phrase fake news is very interesting because it's not just that there's a lot of disinformation out there, but fake news as a phrase is actually used more by the Donald Trumps of this world to devalue real news. And, you know, I think that in a time like this when the world seems to be drifting, you know, in not such a good direction, it's very important. Journalism has a really important role to play. And I'm very passionate about journalism. You can see from practically all the work that I do is connected to journalism. And I still believe in a civilized society. Serious journalism has a very important role to play. So, of course, it's very disturbing to find the value of good journalism being, you know, denigrated by phrases like fake news. In design terms, there's nothing I can really do about that. It's more to do with society and the powerful players in society. But again, it does feed back a little bit to the personality thing. We can't make a reader trust a newspaper or a TV station, but we can at least create a visual environment in which they feel that it might be worth trusting them, and that the people involved in creating the journalism take their job seriously. So, for example, when I was talking about those information graphics on RTL News, you look at a lot of information graphics on television, and you get the feeling that people don't really care about the information and that it doesn't have a value. So part of bringing that kind of really modernistic approach to information design is about celebrating the value of information and saying that we care about information and take it seriously. So of course, you know, I can't use design to say this is not fake news, but I can at least try and create an environment in which the audience reacts to think, well, maybe these guys know what they're doing, so I should listen to them. So many questions. I thought I'd explained it all already.
Hello, thank you for your excellent lecture and the work. you do. I wanted to ask you more about the relationship between graphic designer, photographer, and the author of the text, because I think that these three, they have to work, they have to cooperate together, and especially about editorial work in photography, because I think nowadays, as you said, because we communicate more through the picture, it's utmost important to select the right pictures, and how the practice is nowadays in this cooperation.
Yeah, I think there's still great collaborations going on between publishers and image makers. When I was younger and I was just an art director, you know, art directing magazines all the time, I had very close relationships with the photographers and illustrators. Now that we're doing more kind of projects and systems, I slightly miss that. We do still do some art direction and work with photographers and stuff. I don't do as much of it as I used to do. But yes, the key relationship on a magazine, I think, is between the art director and the editor. Not so much the writer. I'm quite suspicious of writers. You know, I value text and I always love to read. And I admire great writing. But writers often don't understand what makes a good publication. So they can write a brilliant article, but they don't know how to make people read it. It's the editor and the art director who know how to make people read it. But then, you know, beyond that collaboration, which is the absolutely essential one, then your collaborations with your contributors who are making the images and you're working with them are extremely important too. And it's another personality element, really. It's about working out what kind of images project the kind of magazine that you want to be and who you believe in and what you stand for. So as you saw in Colors, you know, we had two kinds of pictures, the documentary images, which were available, somebody else had shot, we had no relationship with the photographer, and the ones that we created ourselves, which had a very, very well-defined style. But that was quite limiting. You know, a lot of magazines will use a much wider range of photography, but the kind of picture that is right for Vanity Fair or Rolling Stone is not going to be right for, you know, 032C. So, you work out a kind of group of people who make images that you think fit with your view of the world, and a successful collaboration with them is extremely important in making any good publication, for sure. But, there's still great image making going on out there. There are still great art directors and photo editors getting the best out of photographers. But I think it's very important to say that, in the end, the right picture for the magazine is not always the ideal picture. And this is something that I sometimes have run-ins with photo editors about. You make a picture selection, or you decide to crop an image, and they say, no, this is the best picture, or you can't crop that image, because they tend to think of the images as something that exists in some kind of platonic space, or maybe on a gallery wall. But on the page of a magazine, that's not how it works. You know, there's a picture that will be a great magazine page. There's not necessarily the picture that you want to see on the wall of a gallery. So that's where the art director's skill comes in. Benjamin, I can hear you. You don't need a microphone.
So you've had such like a luxury, I suppose, of being able to commission type.
Yeah. I think, so to anyone who couldn't hear, Benjamin's asking that if you had the budget, would I always commission a special typeface for every project? I think in most cases I would, because it's just a way of having your own personality, and it's easier to have your own personality with a custom typeface. But sometimes there are typefaces that have stories that come with them which make them right for the project, like Forma for Domus. You know, the more I found about it, the more I found that it was completely connected to the world that Domus had grown out of in Milan in the 1950s and so on. So that was obviously a better choice than commissioning something custom. I think there is a little bit of a danger, particularly in magazines and newspapers and television, where you're restricted by readability, that sometimes people make typefaces that actually are so much like other typefaces, there's no point in spending the money, because, you know, you can't in most cases in a magazine that's going to a wide audience, you can't use a kind of crazy eccentric typeface. You know, you have to bear in mind that some of the people reading these newspapers are as old as my father and they haven't got very good eyesight. So, you know, there's a fairly limited range. And in fact, that's why I was so pleased with what we did with the Guardian typeface. We actually managed to make a newspaper typeface that didn't look like any other typeface. But yeah, of course, it's brilliant luxury working with type designers and they're amazing people. And if I had the money, I would get a custom typeface for everything. Why not?
Anybody else?
I'm going to lose my voice in a minute.
Yeah, sorry.
That's cool.
Well, I was just curious about the ethical and moral implications of design and kind of how you try and approach that when looking at news content.
Okay. In many ways, you know, being a publication designer or doing, you know, websites is an ecological disaster because, you know, paper production, even recycled paper, you know, it is often, it's not ideal. People had the, I used to get challenged when I was a print designer by people saying, everything should be digital now. Why are you still, you know, making all this stuff out of dead trees? Surely it's bad for the environment. But actually, digital products are much worse for the environment because they all require enormous server farms, which use insane amounts of energy. So in many ways, you know, if you look at the moral dimension of what you're doing in that sense, you have to say, well, maybe I should just give up and stop doing this stuff. There should be less magazines and websites in the world. On the other hand, I've been lucky enough to work with some people doing amazing journalism, telling incredible stories, talking truth to power, and actually making the world a better place. So I kind of weigh those up against each other, and I say that actually I'm okay, because what I'm doing is helping to spread the message of great journalism, which is good for the world and good for democracy. But yeah, there definitely is a moral dimension to what we do, because some of the stories that you're dealing with are politically sensitive, or they're about really important things going on in the world that people don't want to know about. So you have to approach it with a sense of humility. And that's another reason why you try not to put too much of your personality into it. You know, if some reporter has gone to Syria or some photographer has gone to some really dangerous place in the world, the last thing they need is me trying to make it look cool. I'm just there to sort of create an environment in which people can respond to their work. So yeah, I've just been lucky that most of my clients are people who are doing good in the world, and that enables me to feel good about what I do.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.